Hello guys, Aloy Andalus here. On this video, we will see a quick overview of Arnold Renderer on 3ds Max. How to use it, materials, lighting, render settings, usual techniques if you come from other renderers, etc. You can jump to any chapter easily using the timeline below, but first we will do a small recap of the history of Arnold and how we arrived here. This video is sponsored by Autodesk, thanks so much. Arnold is a Monte Carlo ray tracing renderer. It's unbiased, physical based, and a ray tracing 3D rendering engine. Created by the company Solid Angle, founded by Marcos Fajardo, Arnold started initial planning around 1997, and at the beginning was known as Render API, finally changed the name to Arnold. Maybe not so many people knows that, but Arnold's first development was as a plugin for 3ds Max. One of the first users of Arnold was by the animator Daniel Martinez Lara. On this video you can see this animation on initial test using 3ds Max 3.1. This test will evolve into a short film called Pepe that was released in 1999. That was a huge sensation by the time, where full GI flicker-free animations were not easy to achieve. At first, Arnold was only licensed to big studios, was not possible to be bought by individuals. First license was to Micros Image in 2001, it was followed by Sonic Picture Imageworks that adopt Arnold as main renderer, and they keep developing Arnold together with Solid Angle. Creating in 2006 Monster House, that was the first animated feature film entirely rendered with a brute force path tracing renderer. Another very famous milestone in the CG industry was the short film Parthenon by Paul de Bebeck that was rendered using Arnold in 2004. During next years, multiple big studios follow incorporating Arnold as main renderer, like Ilion Animation Studios, Platige Image, Digipictures, Rising Sun Pictures, Trickster, Rodeo, Image Engine, The Embassy, and much more. Finally, in 2016, Solid Angle was acquired by Autodesk. It was introduced in 3ds Max 2018 using Max2A, that is the bridge between 3ds Max and Arnold, and in 3ds Max 2021, Arnold has become the default renderer in 3ds Max, replacing for first time the all-good Scanline renderer. Let's start using Arnold in 3ds Max. Since 2021, if you just press render or F9, you will be rendering using Arnold because now it's the default renderer. This is the production renderer, aiming for final render production. If you want faster feedback of what you are changing, you can change the render to active shade mode. In this mode, Arnold by default renders in a progressive way, adapting to whatever you change in your scene. Since Max 2020, we as well have active shade in viewport. This will render Arnold inside your viewport, and selections, helpers, gizmos, or wireframes mode are still visible. In 2021.3, a viewport resolution multiplier has been added that is ideal if you have a 4K monitor, for example, to switch the resolution depending on what you need. In the newer versions of Max2A, it includes as well Arnold Render View. This frame buffer is the same in all Arnold renderers, so it's the same in Maya, Cinema 4D, Houdini, and Max, and has a lot of advantage over the old Max frame buffer. For example, you can select objects directly from Arnold Render View and isolate them, so the renderer will only render these objects being way faster. You have region rendering, you can create snapshots and compare them directly on the Arnold render view. You have multiple renderer elements to debug what's going on, post-production effects, and a big etc. I totally recommend that you start using Arnold render view over the old frame buffer. Let's see lights. Arnold supports photometric lights and Arnold lights. Personally, I prefer Arnold lights, but it's totally up to you. You can create them as any regular light in 3ds Max. You have only one light, but when you have it created, you can select multiple different types of lights. The default is a quad light. It's the one that I use more often, and it's basically an area light. Quad X and quad Y defines the dimensions of your area light. Then you have color intensity, where you can control colors in different ways by directly color or temperature, and you have two ways to control intensity. One value multiplies the other. With exposure, you will define the overall value, and with intensity, you will fine-tune the final resulting intensity. I like a lot roundness, soft edges in Arnold lights. In real life, an area light is not a flat uniform color. Because these lights can be visible on reflections, you will like to have or an HDRI image to break the perfect lines on a crisp reflection, or instead you can use these values. One will make your lights to be softer on the edges, and the other one will round the edge. The last value I found interesting in Arnold light is a spread. To visualize this, let's make a parenthesis here and let's showcase how to add volumetrics in your scene. Open in one side Render Settings with F10 and go to the Scene Atmosphere. Here we can connect two Arnold effects, one is Arnold Fog, this one is very similar to V-Ray Aerial Perspective. It's a fast approach to see distant objects more desaturated. Or we can create as well Atmosphere Volume that will create a true volume that will scatter light. Connect Atmosphere Volume to a Scene Atmosphere and tweak the values. You will see that at the beginning can be too strong. Adjust it until the density makes sense. With this is a perfect way to showcase a spread on the light. Basically, a spread of 0 will create a very directional light, even it's an area light, while a spread of 1 will scatter lights in all directions. So middle values will create a cone effect. Going back to Arnold Render View, isolation also works with lights, so instead of selecting objects, if you select a light, all your objects will be visible, but only the light that you have selected or multiple lights that you have selected will be visible on the final render. This way, instead of turning on or off lights to see each light how much contribution they do on the final scene, you can turn on isolation mode and select each light individually. This is a huge time saver for me. Arnold has his own set of materials. The main one being Arnold Standard Surface. It's not different than V-Ray material or any other physical material. You control diffuse color, roughness, refractions, etc. with a lot of very specific controls for Arnold. If you feel overwhelmed by it, a good solution is to use physical material. This material is standard in 3ds Max, works with Arnold, but as well with V-Ray, Art, Scanline, Final Render and others, so you can switch between one and or the other. Another advantage of physical material is that displays nicely on viewport any PBR property, and it has built-in presets, so it's very easy if you are new to simply choose one of these presets and see how it works. Arnold works natively with OSL, being faster than other options working with this type of materials. Supports any OSL shipped with 3ds Max or any other that you can download or create yourself. If you don't see the legacy materials from 3ds Max, it's because by default they are not supported. You can enable them turning on legacy 3ds Max map materials on system windows. This will work only inside 3ds Max and with CPU. And I totally suggest that you start discovering our Arnold custom shaders or the new OSL that works great in Arnold and start getting over the old legacy maps. If you need to override all materials for debugging or for a quick render, you can do it adding your material on Shader Override under Diagnostic tab. A usual way to illuminate is using HDRI image. Let's see how to do it in Arnold. Open your environment, key 8. When the background color is set to pure black, means no illumination from environment. As soon as you add some color, you will start seeing that this color will be affecting the illumination of your object. Arnold is using IBL to light, and you can connect as well any texture in the environment map slot instead. I will suggest using the OSL HDRI environment. And now your scene will be lighted depending on this image. Changing the image will change the illumination of your scene. The good thing of this OSL, first is that it doesn't work only with Arnold, and then is that you can control everything. You can control the rotation of the environment, saturation, tint color, and anything you need. Something cool as well is that you can project the floor to have the appearance that your 3D object is sitting over a physical floor. If you need your HDRI to be illuminating your scene, but not be visible on viewport or at render time, you have two options. One is select the OSL HDRI environment map, and it has a built-in use custom background. Simply select black, and here you go. The other will be to go to Arnold Render, go to Background Properties and switch Scene Environment for None. Now, with Arnold Render View, you can change the background to any color that you want or to select an image from there. Now, maybe you will need a matte shadow object, and here is how you do it in Arnold. Create a shadow matte map and connect it to Map to Material. Then you apply this to the surface that you need to have shadows projected, and here you go, matte shadow in Arnold. Working in look depth, normally you will use Arnold Render View, because you can iterate really fast. It's creating a progressive refinement, and this progressive refinement actually is not controlled by this value or this value. It's controlled by the render progressive refinement value. You can deactivate that, but doesn't make many sense to work with Arnold Render View with the progressive off, because as you can see, it's not as interactive. So the progressive refinement, what it's doing, it's showing your image all at once and then refining progressively. The preview and the progressive, it's not doing anything there. The effect that these values has are on the when you press F9 and you render with the old frame buffer of 3ds Max. This old frame buffer is has way less features than the Arnold Render View, and at some point Arnold Render View will take over. It's still there for compatibility, but most of the time I will use only Arnold Render View. But take into account that when we render, we don't see the preview that we were seeing at the beginning. If you want to see it, press preview. Now at the beginning, you can see that it creates this, it showcases the image all at once. If you are rendering for production, for final production, you want this off, because this preview, it's taking maybe some seconds, and that when you render a sequence, you don't want this to be calculated over and over. And the progressive render, take in mind that as well for final product, maybe you want to take it off, because it creates a progressive refinement, as you can see. So you can see the image being clear, but it can take more memory and it can take more time. I only use progressive render and preview when I'm working with an Arnold Render View, and because you are dealing with this automatically, don't activate that if you are using Arnold Render View. Finally, what happens if you want to use your GPU? Because all of this, we have been doing it on the CPU, but Arnold, since 1 year and more, has GPU acceleration. You only need to go to system, and on the render device, you can switch CPU for GPU. You need an NVIDIA card, and if you have a new RTX, it will be way faster, but with non-RTX, it works as well. I have an old one, as you can see here, it's a GTX 960M, and you don't need to do anything, actually. You will see that it will refine much faster. Maybe it has a little more noise. And one of the differences, if you go to Arnold Renderer, everything is the same, but all the individual passes that we will see later what they do are enabled on the GPU side. Kind of like it's a little more stupid, so you cannot refine or tweak these values independently. You only have camera subsamples. So you can go with higher values because you need a little more subsamples to have a cleaner image, but basically it's the same. Difference between GPU and CPU in Arnold has been improving a lot. If you try Arnold GPU 1 year ago, you will see that there is a lot of things not working. Now a lot of things works. Arnold is one of the few renderers that works with OSL in GPU mode. Maybe some specific features of OSL are not yet compatible, but they are working more and more into have full compatibility. So you will be able to render CPU and GPU and have exactly the same results. In other renderers, you are used to render elements tab, where you define different passes that you will need in COM. In Arnold, instead we have arbitrary output variables, or AOB for short. We have as well AOB like group manager. Here you can organize your still lights by groups and give them names. Then you can go to the AOB manager, that will be your render elements. And we have an AOB wizard for quick setups, or you can go to AOB list to see the full list of passes. Here you can see all elements that you need, the equivalents from your render elements. You have as well CryptoMath elements, and it's as easy as drag and drop to create your AOBs. You can define here all the parameters you need. Also, you can specify which set of lights to render, so we can use the groups that we defined before here. Another difference is that for outputs, we can use tokens. So instead of defining a specific folder, you add a variable. This variable can be project folder, project name, camera name, etc. This way you don't need to define folders manually per camera or per scene. It's one of these things that you cannot live without once you try it. Finally, you can save presets to later reuse them, that it's really useful. And after trying AOB's interface, I doubt that you want to go back to the old render elements. It's really good. Once you render with Arnold Render View, all your elements will be visible there. Arnold Render settings are very easy, but people can be a little overwhelmed because you see a lot of numbers all at once, but let's see what they do. These values on the right, it's simple information. It's to know how many total rays are you firing per pixel. Next, we have ray depth. These are how many bounces a ray is having into the scene. For example, for diffuse, more ray depth means indirect lighting will bounce more times, illuminating the shadow darkest areas of the image. For a specular, ray depth here means how many times one reflected object will reflect inside the other reflected object. Finally, we have the samples. You have it defined by different elements like diffuse, specular, transmission, SSS, and volume indirect, and it means how many samples you will have on each of these areas. If your noise comes from a specular, you want to just increase the specular samples. If your noise comes from indirect illumination, you want to increase diffuse samples. And finally, we have the camera AA, that are the numbers of samples per pixel fired from the camera. More camera samples means more anti-alias quality, and this value is multiplying all the other values, diffuse, specular, etc. So if you are lazy, you can just control the quality of the renderer with this only value, the camera AA, at the expense of adding extra render time that maybe you will not need. The two only values that can only be improved with camera AA are depth of field and motion blur, that you will need to crank up camera AA because there is no other option. Let's see on this example how I will try to clean noise on this image. You can see that there is a lot of noise, and we could start increasing camera AA, but I can see that this noise is coming from shadows, so let's increase first sampling on the lights. Every light has a sampling multiplier, so let's increase this sample multiplying, and you can see that the noise is reduced a lot. But now, we can see we introduce a different type of noise. It's kind of like fireflies. My instinct is telling me that this can come from indirect illumination, because all lights are inside the houses, and all the exterior surface is lit by light bouncing. To see if this is the case, let's turn off diffuse ray depth to zero. The diffuse light is not bouncing, so no GI, we only have direct lighting. And we can see that this noise disappears totally. So, means that the noise comes from the diffuse. So now that we know that, we can simply crank up the diffuse values. We could instead just increasing camera AA, but this will mean increase all the subsamples for everything on the scene, and you don't need it because now you know that it's coming from the diffuse. So with diffuse at 6, you can see that the image is totally clear. If you need a fast render, you can keep the camera subsamples low, I will keep it at 1, and instead we will use denoising. Go to the denoising tab and turn on apply on beauty for the optics denoiser. This will render your image as usual, now with very low samples, and at the end it will apply this denoising effect that cleans a lot of the noise. In a lot of renderers, you control object visibility, shadow casting, and others using object properties in 3ds Max. But in Arnold, these values doesn't do anything. So instead, Arnold has his own thing that it's called Arnold Properties Modifier. You found it on Modifier. So you can select your object or groups of objects and you apply this Arnold modifier. And here you can define all types of properties that you possibly need. In this case, I will convert these objects as a matte and you can see that has direct effect on them. To do this procedurally, Arnold has as well a very powerful node editor to change these object properties at render time. They are called Arnold operators. You can turn on off visibility, or intensities, or change materials. You can do whatever you want in a procedural way. This alone will take a lot of time to cover how it works, so only know that it exists, and you can check for more information if you are interested. It's a very interesting feature from Arnold. Arnold has multiple additional objects, like Alembic importer to import Alembic files, volume to import VDB files, and a USD importer. Procedural objects is what Arnold calls his instances. It's the same as V-Ray proxy, and they are really powerful and memory efficient. You can create them individually, or you can use particle flow to scatter particles and create procedurals on each particle, and it is as well supported by tie flow or forest pack to create huge instancing on your scenes. For extra information in Arnold, you have the Arnold online help that is really good. You have multiple tutorials for scene creation, shading creation. All the scenes that you saw on this video are coming from the Arnold online help. You can download them from there. You have the Arnold rendering blog by Lee Griggs. It's another place that you will find a lot of examples and tutorials. Lee is creating most of the Arnold tutorials for Autodesk. Mats has as well a free Arnold converter that it's ideal to move existing scenes from V-Ray or other renderers to Arnold, keeping all materials and maps with the minimum effort. He has as well different utilities like an ambient occlusion light shader for very fast ambient occlusion in Arnold, really interesting, check it out. And Jose M. Elizardo has multiple tutorials in YouTube, and Arnold Renderer has as well a YouTube channel, all the links will be below. I am an old V-Ray user. In the past I used Brazil, I used Mental Ray, I used a lot of Scanline, and I am still using a lot V-Ray at work. But at home, I started using Arnold for a couple of years now, and it offers all what I need, and it's perfect for effects, motion graphics, and we are getting new versions every 2 months or less, and it's improving at a great pace. It's curious because Arnold in different packages is really popular, Maya, Houdini, Cinema 4D, and in Max, that it's part of the package, you have one license for free of Arnold, it's not so popular so far. I think that it's because Max 2A has been integrated 3 years ago, and at the beginning the integration was not so good, it needed a couple of years to be better integrated in Max, but now it is, and I think that it's an excellent renderer, it has been used so many times, it's a production solid renderer. So, guys, let me know in the comments, are you using Arnold? You think that you will change to Arnold because you are using something else? Let me know what you are using and if you are thinking to go to Arnold or why you don't want to go to Arnold. And let me know if you would like that I produce more tutorials for Arnold. I am not a renderer, I used to render a lot before, some years ago, but I am more focused on effects. I render some basic things and at home I do some stuff, but I am not an expert on rendering. But if you want that I cover some basics in Arnold, I can do it if people is asking for it. So thank you a lot, guys. Please, as you always, this was a long tutorial. So if you like it, share it with your friends, give a comment, like, subscribe if you are new to the channel, and thanks a lot to all my Patreons, it's helping me a lot to do these tutorials, it's a lot of effort to cover all this and put all this together and edit, so thank you a lot guys and see you soon, bye!